discuss the mechanism of stochastic resonance, which is the part of the motivation of the novel of Giorgio Parisi,
Sorry to interrupt.
referring to, yes?
Camera, you need to be adjusted. So,
It's okay?
yeah, okay, so thank
Yeah,
you.
that's fine.
Okay, so now it's okay. Sorry, because I have two screens in front of me. So, okay. Now, it's a part of the motivation that is planetary, no? From atomic scale to planetary. I mean, this is rather astonishing, right? Because I never heard of a Nobel Prize that was given to a wide range of problems like the one that Giorgio was able to work on. And I will try to make it clear how the problem was discussed, was entering in our framework, and how it was born, this idea. And I mean, what you can say about the climate in this case. So everything starts from this graph. I mean, not this particular one, which is one snapshot of many similar results that you get from paleoclimatic records, where you can reconstruct in a way which is really very difficult. I don't know exactly all the details, the behavior of the temperature during the last 1 million years. Actually, people can do even more than 1 million years, but we will focus on 1 million years because in the last 1 million years, these are snapshots going from the present climate here to the 400,000 years ago. And the blue line referred to the temperature, more or less in the, I think it was somewhere in the Greenland. At any rate, what you see is the temperature that was showing two different states, so to speak. One is the present climate, which is the one which we live, it's interglacial. And then there is a glacial climate. And there are behavior which are almost, not exactly, but almost periodic. In fact, if you do the power spectrum over the last 1 million years, what you see is the dominant effect is the 100,000 year cycle, which is famous in climate approach. Now, we start together with Alfonso, Angelo, and Giorgio to discuss how it is possible to explain this behavior. And the problem is that there was a qualitative theory done by Milutin Milanković, a geophysicist, engineering, and mathematician Serbian, that during almost 20 years he was able to compute analytically many different features of the Earth orbit around the Sun. And what is discovered, among many other things, is that the Earth orbit changed eccentricity with a cycle which was exactly 100,000 years. So people, I mean, people say, okay, this is the reason why we have this behavior in climate change. Actually, if you do things very precisely, you observe that in fact, the eccentricity, which is the only relevant parameter on the global scale, because the obliquity and other features are on average equal to zero on the Earth. But anyway, the eccentricity was the change in the eccentricity was exactly in phase with the change of solar radiation of the paleoclimatic records. What is the problem? I will explain it very clearly, but the problem is that if you do this computation and you look at how much change the solar radiation, which is incoming on the Earth surface, you get a number which is really very small, 0.25 watt per meter square, more or less, which is so small that will give you something that is very small with respect to the temperature. So from the energy point of view, you are unable to explain this possible influence of the sun eccentricity on the climate. How can we do this computation? Now, I mean, you can do this computation in several ways, but our starting point was to consider a very, very simple model, which is essentially the energy balance on the Earth's surface. The model was originally introduced by Buttigieg and Sellers, and it takes into account essentially three different features. One is the incoming solar radiation. Another one is the reflection. Incoming solar radiation essentially is going to the Earth without many change, but is reflected from the Earth's surface. And the reflection, of course, is different if you have ice, clouds, or water, or grass, or sand in the desert. So you have an incoming solar radiation, which is in part reflected exactly as it arrives on the Earth. And then the Earth take the income, what is left from this simple balance, and it emits radiation at a certain temperature T with the Stefan-Boltzmann law, which is slightly modified due to the greenhouse effect in the atmosphere. I mean, the famous greenhouse effect. So this is the basic starting point. Of course, the climate is done by many other mechanisms, by many other scales, but definitely the first point that you should always take into account is the energy budget on the Earth surface, which is the source of energy for all the other mechanisms. Now, in the Buttigieg-Sellers model, what they discover is fundamentally that there is a stable state, which is here, which is our present climate. And then, of course, if you go to very low temperature, something which is minus 150 degrees below this, the temperature that we have now, you have another stable state, which never occurred on climate history, which is called ice cover Earth. Essentially, it's a very simple state, this one, because what you have is that the Earth is essentially covered by ice, so everything which arrives is reflected. And of course, this changes the albedo. This is one minus the albedo. So you have an unstable state somewhere. Okay? So if you compute the effect of Milankovitch-Forchin, what you are doing is to change the incoming solar radiation. So the net balance between what is coming in and what is reflected is changing. And such a change due to the Milankovitch forcing is giving you only 0.2 degree. So you see that this number is very far from what you observe from the present climate to the interglacial, to the glacial climate. When we speak about 10 degrees variation in the glacial climate, we should remember that during the glacial period, about 20,000 years ago, okay, New York, for instance, was covered by something like 3,000 meters of ice. So it's a huge difference. 0.2 degrees, it's very small. So there is this problem. So with Giorgio Alfonso Sudera, which unfortunately is no longer with us, and Angelo, we start to think of this problem. And of course, okay, this is the equation that I spoke about, and then it's an ordinary differential equation, which doesn't tell us anything. But the first assumption we did was that whatever is the mechanism that can produce such periodic behavior in the climate, there should be at least two states. I mean, two states means that we must assume that the albedo is more complicated than, at least in this framework, it's more complicated of what we think, and there should be a state corresponding to our present climate and the glacial state, which is 10 degrees far from ours. Climate. So it's a kind of, if you wish, a Landau-Ginzburg theory for the climate. Of course, when you speak about states, you may question whether we have any evidence about it. The evidence comes from the paleoclimatic record, where we do observe a glacial state. And so it is reasonable to assume that such a state will fit the energy balance, at least over a long time scale. And it is fully consistent with the our knowledge about the albedo. So this was the first step. The second step was one crucial point, and this was done by Alfonso and by myself, Alfonso and another Pandolfo. The paper actually appeared in 81, but it was done in 79, okay? Now, the idea was to follow Asselman, who is the other Nobel Prize with Manabe, on 2021. What Asselman did, from the point of view of stochastic differential equation, the idea is mathematically reasonable and simple, but physically very relevant. He was working on sea surface temperature, and he was working not in a simple equation like the one that I show you here, but it was working at the linear response of the surface sea surface anomaly with respect to the weather behavior. And he introduced the idea that the atmosphere behavior on the ocean, because of the different time scales in the system, can be considered as a white noise perturbation in the exchange of heat and momentum from the atmosphere to the sea. Now, it seems naive, this approach, but it's not naive at all, because it introduced for the first time the idea that you can model something which occurs on very small scale with a noise, with a white noise in this case. Okay, now you can make other theory about that, but I mean, the point is that that was the starting point of considering noise as a driving force of the system to parameterize the variability. This morning during the talk of Giorgio, we hear a question about the infinite time and space scale about climate. Now you are looking at time, and Asselman introduced this intelligent idea about the possibility to understand some of the sea surface anomaly, very successful, by the way, as soon as you generalize this approach to more complex property of sea surface change with the atmosphere, by looking at the wind or the atmosphere as itself as a noise acting on the system, on the dynamics of the system. Now, if you repeat the argument of Asselman in the case of the energy balance for the Earth between the incoming solar radiation and the outgoing solar radiation, what you can compute from the data and from the reasonable estimate of the thermal capacity of Earth is the time scale of the response to external perturbation, which is of the order 6-10 years, and the noise acting on the climate, on the energy balance, because you repeat exactly the same argument by Asselman, and you obtain that the noise acting at the level of energy budget is of the order of 0.2 degrees per square per year. This was something that can be computed, and that was the reason why we start considering the problem in detail, because if you take this noise and you plug this information into this equation, plus the fact that you have two stable states, metastable, as you will see, for the climate, you can compute the average time to go from one state to the other. And this is a computation that you can do using the famous, at that time we didn't know it was called like this, but it's using the famous Cramer formula, or using the formula of stochastic differential equation. So you see, you get a number, 50,000 years, for the average transition time, which is of the order of magnitude that it's interesting because it's exactly the long time scale that you need to understand why there are fluctuations in the climate over a period of 100,000 years. So that was the first step that was done. And this is what Giorgio was referring to this morning when he spoke about the Alfonso talk. Alfonso was giving a talk about these results. And many people said, well, it's a very interesting mathematical exercise, but of course, this does not explain the problem of glacial interglacial cycle, not random jump from one point to another. And then it's not clear exactly what you mean by noise. I mean, there were all these kind of criticism that were at that time reasonable. In fact, we know very well what mean noise-induced transition. I mean, noise-induced transition is exactly a large deviation approach. The typical exercise that I always do to my students is to consider a point particle with large friction in a double well potential, and you want to describe the probability for this quantity to go from one point to the other when you take the particle in a thermal bath or with the noise. So you know that this probability is exponentially small with respect to with the noise variance, and in fact the time scale is exponentially larger with the noise variance. So what happens is that, to the inverse of the noise variance, what happens is that you must have a set of events which point exactly on the top of the potential in order to have a transition. Now, from the climate point of view, it is non-trivial to say something like that, because it is a physical mechanism. Suppose that this is one of the states, for instance, it's the interglacial, the glacial state, then a set of improbable events means that you have a something warmer winter followed by some warmer summer, so that you reduce a little bit the ice, which is, of course, an event which can occur with some probability. But now, if there is a set of winter and summer such that this mechanism go on for a while, then you may recover, you may jump, you may escape from this trap, and you can jump to another climate state. Now, let me remind that that was not so clear in 1971, which is 79, because many people thought, especially in the climate community, that the change, transition due to the noise was due to the fact that at a certain point you have a very large value of the noise, which makes the system to cross the barrier in extremely short time. And this, the reason why people thought like this, because when you see the numerical simulation of a problem like this, what you observe are sharp transitions. And sharp transitions in your mind means that essentially what you have is you stay in one of the two wells, and then there is a huge fluctuation in the noise, which brings you to the other side, which is actually wrong. Now, the noise, the concept of noise itself, it's at least difficult to accept, because essentially what we did with this model was to consider only the energy balance and all the complicated feedback which are known to exist in the climate. We call it noise. But the concept of noise, it's in this case different from what we physically consider noise, for instance, in a thermal bath or in statistical mechanics. So let me give you an example, which I think it's very, very nice. This is an experimental paper done by Joël Sommerier. You have a layer very thin layer of metallic liquid, which you can excite, very thin, okay? So the horizontal scale is much bigger than the vertical scale. So it's essentially a two-dimensional layer, which you can excite at small scale. So here is one example. You can excite at small scale by introducing a current from an electrode here. And then you can put other sensor in order to measure the velocity. Okay, now we know that in two-dimensional flow like this one, if you have turbulence at small scale, then energy is going to the very large scale. It was discussed a few minutes ago by George and Angelo. So there is an energy flux which goes from small scale to large. However, the system is finite, so sooner or later this energy flux will be stopped. And in fact, what happens is that you have a turbulent state which fluctuates on average around some mean field. And this mean field, which is turbulent anyhow, can be clockwise or anticlockwise. So what you can see here is the results of the experiments where this figure illustrates the behavior of the velocity that was measured in the system. And you see that there are two states, which there should be there, because the system has two possibilities on a very long time scale. I mean, this is our kiloseconds, so it's thousands of seconds. And there are transition from one state to another. Now, this is a fluid system with no noise. I mean, there is no thermal noise in the system. So the transitions are induced by what we call turbulence. But if you look at the system from the point of view of the average, then you can imagine that such a transition can be due to noise, and you call noise what is called, in fact, turbulence. There are other examples. For instance, in 97, there was a nice paper by Michael Gilswin and other people, Eric Weeks and so on, where they look at the behavior in a rotating annulus with some mountains inside. They look at the rotator of the behavior of the velocity at certain scale here, and they show that there are two different configurations which correspond to two different states in the system, and you can make transition between one state to the other. There are other cases, like for instance in the reversal of dynamo or in the thermal convection, where you observe the existence of two different states and there are sharp transition between two states. Now you can imagine to deal with this system regardless of the detailed dynamics, but assuming that there is some equivalence with some value of noise. In fact, at the end of a certain point, we decided to make a numerical simulation using a model for the Navier-Stokes equation with exactly the case of where the large scale was forced in order to have two different possible values, one positive and one negative. And there is no noise in this simulation, and the reversals are random with a probability distribution which agree with the stochastic differential equation. And what is interesting that when people cite this paper about the effect of turbulence in the transition between different states, they say that this simulation was done with the noise, which is not true. It's not done with the noise. There is no noise at all in this simulation. The reason why they say that is because if you compare the simulation with the previous one that I showed you before with the noise, they seem so close together that the idea is that in fact you are using noise to make the simulation, but it's absolutely wrong. So you see that the effect of noise in our model is definitely similar to what Assermann was thinking, but it was making the work of simulating everything that we actually do not know about the climate variability and the mechanism. Of course, that was at the level of energy surface. So it was at the level of the energy budget, of the energy budget of the Earth. Now, unfortunately, the noise is not enough. Okay, obviously, this is a strong assumption, but there was a lot of discussion inside the community about this idea that noise can drive the transition. Now, this discussion never stopped. I mean, if I speak with some colleague, they always say that it's impossible that noise drive, that it's impossible that you find a system where the noise, without noise, I mean, turbulence or whatever, can drive the transition. But I mean, it's a matter of performing a kind of approximation, which is to capture the essential physical point, not the details of the mechanism that is going to make the transition, okay? But in any case, even if we use the noise and we got this fantastic 5,000 years for long time effect of the noise in the system, it doesn't solve the problem because the noise will give you a system which make transition at random times. So at this point arrived Giorgio, and Giorgio said, okay, but if you now introduce the effect of solar radiation, which is small, this effect will enter in the average time exponentially and will be divided by the noise variance, which as you remember, was small. So it can be not trivial, it can be rather large, okay? So we start to discuss how to compute this effect. And the problem was that at that time, we were trying to do it analytically, trying to find out the solution of the backwards Kolmogorov equation. But unfortunately, there was a lack of knowledge about how to compute the probability distribution of the exit time from in this case, and it was very difficult because you have no stationarity in this equation. So we decided to make a numerical simulation, okay? And in fact, at the time I'm speaking about, we know how to compute the value of average time, but we didn't know how to compute its square, okay? Then we became expert and we now know how to compute all the moments, okay? And so with Angelo, we decided to perform a numerical simulation. The amazing thing is that the first time we did the numerical simulation, we got exactly the good results. Never happened, but just in case it happened. Okay, and the other story, which is the first thing we did was to phone to Alfonso in Yale at 3 o'clock in the night. We didn't call to Giorgio, okay? We called Giorgio the morning after. But the first thing we did was to phone Alfonso, and then we went out to buy something to eat because we were excited with a lot of excitation, we decided to go to eat something. However, our laboratory was just in front of the building of the major political party in Roma, in Italy. And that was a very dangerous time to go around in the night. And in fact, in front of the major political party, there were a lot of police that stopped us trying to understand what we were doing in the night with some food, okay? So we start to discuss saying we were doing simulation for climate change, and that was a very strange excuse. But what solved the problem was that we had a letter from the director that allowed us to work in the empty building, and so we escaped to be arrested. Okay. At any rate, the point is the following: it's true that the forcing is extremely small, but it changes the shape of the potential. It goes up and it goes down. So it is clear that the probability to make a jump in this condition or in this condition is completely different. Here you have a jump with a very small average time, and here you have a jump with a very long average time. So if you do numerical simulation, you see that when there is no noise, okay, you see some oscillation around the present climate, When there is no forcing, you see the jump between the two climate states. But if you put all things together, you see that the jumping is exactly in phase with the forcing, which is the point raised that nobody was able to understand actually, not only because of the variance, but also because of the phase between the effect of solar variation with the climate record. Okay, that was the reason why we were so excited, because in this case we were able to understand, to explain, okay, which was a possible basic mechanism to explain glacial interglacial variation. And that was the paper published in 1982 with the original figures that at that time was done by hand, I remember. Now, after that paper, I went to Erice, where there was a meeting on climate, and everything was very nice. I mean, we got a lot of enthusiastic results from our work. But the story is that the paper was refused twice, one from science and one from atmospheric science. Okay, so the paper was not accepted by the community. And the reason was one because of the noise and one because of the strange mechanism that we were providing. The reason why it's called stochastic resonance is my fault. Okay, it's my fault because when I discussed this model with John Imbrie was a fantastic guy. He was one of the experts on paleoclimatic records. So was the guy that can know everything about interglacial and glacial transition. And he was in Erice. So when I discussed with him, he asked me whether this was a resonance. So I had no courage to say that this has nothing to do with resonance. And so I say, no, it is not a resonance, it's a stochastic resonance. And we like altogether the name, and we decided stochastic resonance was a good name for it. Actually, it was a good name also for the following reason, because from this is a qualitative picture, but if you look at the signal to noise ratio in this particular system, and you look how the signal to noise ratio change with the effect of the noise, you see that there is a behavior where for small noise, of course, the signal to noise ratio is small, for large noise is small as well. And there is only a region where you have a suitable signal to noise ratio, which corresponds to the noise. This means to particular value of the noise. This means, for instance, that the stochastic resonance is a little bit counterintuitive. Suppose that you have a system like this with a small noise, the system is disordered. And then when you increase the noise, the system becomes ordered. So this is the reason why many people behind climate change were interested in these results. Now, there are some few historical results. One of them was on the statistical property of the random times. And there were some few mathematicians that were saying that it was not possible to get a periodic system. And the reason why was it was impossible to make a clear-cut solution from an exact solution from the starting equation. Another problem was the way in which we performed the numerical computation, because at that time there were very few numerical simulations with this kind of problems. And then remember that in 1979-80, it was just the beginning of the theory of Gauss. And so all many ideas concerning what we were doing were just not known at that time, okay? Another criticism was about the sharp transition. That was really a major problem, because many people say, but you observe a change in the climate record, but this change is sharp. We do not observe sharp transition in climate record. Now, there are several ways to answer to this question. One is, of course, to say that, okay, but who cares about sharp transition? This model is just a model of energy budget. What you look at the paleoclimatic record is not the energy budget, but is the results of many other things. So it is not exactly one-to-one correspondence. But the interesting point was that 20 years later, Halley was able to make a very detailed analysis of the last 100 years, and they found that, in fact, the sharp transitions are the rules and not the exception. And so, in fact, sharp transition in climate change has been observed many, many times. And the fact that you do observe some transition is difficult to explain, but the sharp transition in the sense that I explained you before, I mean, like the probability to have a lot of events which goes in one direction in the sense of large deviations, it makes a lot of sense. An interesting point regards the last 60,000 years, which are reported on the figure below. If you look at this figure, you observe many changes, and these changes have been analyzed by the resident time distribution. In particular, Halley was able to, he proposed that this change during the glacial period were also showing one property that is coherent with the stochastic resonance, namely that these are change in the glacial period. So it has nothing to do with the glacial interglacial time scale, but only in the glacial period. So it was reported the change for the glacial period, and it showed, here is the original record, and it showed that in fact the resident time distribution is consistent with the idea that the system has two possible states with some stochastic resonance occurring with a frequency which was faster than the one corresponding to the perfect behavior, to the signal of two noise ratio, perfect behavior of the stochastic resonance itself. Later on, a few years later, Ganopolsky and Ramshot provided a simple model that was able to explain in terms of the Gulf Stream circulation that in fact there may exist two states during in this glacial state, two other states, okay, which are able to make switch one through another. And their model suggests that, in fact, the stochastic resonance is acting. I was very pleased to see this paper because this paper was the signature that the idea of stochastic resonance and the effects introduced by the noise was finally introduced in climate model. Now we go to February 81, and we were very depressed because the paper was not published. We were doing a lot of lectures around, but at that point we understood that two things. First of all, we became clever from the theoretical side, okay? So we understood how to compute the moments of the exit time distribution, and it was enough for us to control the variance, the second moment, to provide a theoretical framework for the stochastic resonance. And the second thing was a simple generalization of the original idea to include the effect of chaotic behavior. And so for this reason, we wrote a paper in 81, which appeared before the paper of 82 with Giorgio. So the reason why the original idea that we were discussing with Giorgio was published after the paper that we published in 81 is due essentially to this mismatch between our approach and the fact that the paper was refused two times, okay? Now let's come to the last part of my talk. Now, we'll try to make a point, which I think everything agree on, but it's better to do it once forever. Now, this is a climate record over the last, let's say, 64, 100 million years. Now, it's in log of the time. No? You have to forget about, you have not to ask me the precision of this information because I don't know. But here you see the last 1 million years in log of time. And these are the 100,000 year cycle. And this is the last period where we are. And this is where we are now, okay, more or less. So this is the temperature. And roughly speaking, 64,000 million years ago was the period of time where big dinosaurs were living on the Earth, okay? Now, if you now look at this period, last 100,000 years, you see that this is the oscillation of Halley that was discussed before. This is the interglacial period. This is our present climate. This is the amount of O18 abundancy in the ice core, which is larger when the system is colder and smaller when the system is warmer. So more or less, this is the picture of the temperature, okay? Now you go to the last 200 years, and you see the famous picture of climate change that is discussing right now. Now, if you look at this graph, having in mind your educated skill about statistical mechanics, it is difficult to understand why people call this an important fluctuation, okay? This is a fluctuation, like many others, that has been observed in climate record. And this is the standard argument that has been given by people that do not believe in the effect of climate change right now. I mean, what they do is to look at the records, and from a statistical point of view, you are not able to say anything if you go very far in the past. But this is wrong. Because what you have to do is to look to the physics, not to the statistical records. What the climate change has we discussed so far has to do is to this amount of energy which is put inside the atmosphere right now, by the sun, sorry. What we are putting inside the atmosphere in the last 50, 60 years is this red box here. So we are now introducing in the atmosphere sometimes like 10 times more energy than the energy coming from the sun, which is producing the climate change of 10 degrees, more or less. So it is clear that from the energy point of view, it's a huge amount of energy that we are perturbing the system, not a small amount. I mean, it's nothing to do with some perturbation. So if you look at the process instead of the records of temperature, which anyhow is a proxy, it's not the climate, okay, you understand that the situation is completely different with respect to the one that you can imagine just looking at the fluctuation of the temperature year by year, okay? Let me tell you the final word. The final word is that it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun because beside the fact that we were working one in Yale, the other one, the other three in Roma, it was a lot of fun working with Giorgio, discussing, working with Alfonso, with Angelo. And it was a lot of fun also discussing with our colleagues about the effects of the noise in climate. And I thank you, all of you, for listening to my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Roberto. We have some time for some questions.
No question, good question.
No, there's one from Prasad. Prasad, could you try to unmute yourself? Let me help you. Yeah, Prasad, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, hello, Roberto.
Hello, Prasad.
Yeah, just a quick question. I mean, the reversals that you talked about, right? I mean, but we also know like Rayleigh-Benard convection, and even in some 2D systems, there have been now lots of experiments which show reversals of roles and other things. So is there also a simple way to understand that physics in terms of some mechanics? Because those are much more controlled systems, right? So is there a way one could think in terms of some mechanism by which you have a deterministic term? Plus, and can we even model the noise to then say that, that's also stochastic resonance with a certain period?
I mean, even in my simulation with the simplified model of turbulence, the reversal are due to the deterministic path, okay? There is no noise which is acting in the system. So it is clear that the reversal take place in a dynamical system with respect to, I mean, the standard normal form theory that you can write about the instability, which is considering, and the effect of the fact that the system is chaotic. So now the problem is whether, I mean, the signature that you should look at is the probability distribution of the time of reversal. If the probability distribution is exponential, like for instance, even in the Lorentz model, okay, then it is reasonably clear that everything goes as if it is a noise.
Okay.
Now, of course, this is not exactly true. For instance, I give you an example. If you play this game with the other kind of system, like in magneto hydrodynamics or even with the polymer, what happens is that when you introduce a forcing, the forcing change the fluctuation. The fluctuation change the statistical states and change the probability distribution. So, in other words, the so-called the state in the case of a complicated nonlinear and chaotic model can be the results of a complicated equilibrium. So when you put the forcing inside, the equilibrium can be changed in a way that you cannot predict from a simple stochastic differential equation.
Yeah.
But the signature to have a stochastic to have the same effect of stochastic differential equation is the probability distribution of the reversal time.
So if that's exponential, then you would
If it is exponential, then you can put an amplitude and see whether you get the results.
Results. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Sergio, you had a question, right?
Yes, sir. Hi, Roberto.
Hi, Roberto.
It was very nice to hear the detailed story about that. We talk about that many times, but I am surprised, I mean, by the fact that you said at the end of the story, you were rather lucky in putting the right amount of noise in the first time you did. Because suppose that you have put too much noise or not much, you would not see anything.
Well, the word lucky, it's correct, but the point is the following. You have an exponential, I mean, the average time depends exponentially on the inverse of noise, okay? So the first thing we did was to understand whether our estimate of noise was reasonable to get the time scale around 50,000 years. Now, when you get these results, then you, of course, if you change the noise by factor two, you are changing everything, okay? And this is what we did afterwards. But when you have these results, you essentially are more or less within constraints. You cannot do much more than that, okay? So that was the reason why we were in some sense lucky, but in another sense clever to understand that we should look at the noise with some care because of the exponential estimate.
Yeah.
This is always the problem with an exponential estimate. So I agree with you. If we start, if we had started with an item that was four times bigger or four times smaller, then we were unable to get anything, and my talk today was not given. That's true. But lucky is a part of life, as usual.
Srikant, Sergio, do you have a follow-up, or I can ask Srikant for the next question?
Hi, Sastri. How are you?
How are you? So thanks very much. That was a very educative talk. Now, one thing that you sort of mentioned as the very first step in your attempts to rationalize from the original energy balance equation that you started with was to introduce this additional stable value, which corresponded to a 10 degree change. And you mentioned it as sort of an assumption that you made, but you didn't go back to it.
You're right. I mean, we were inspired from this point of view by a paper of Michael Gill, I guess it was on 77, where he was using the Budico-Seller model, and he was taking in consideration the effect of clouds in the albedo when you lower the temperature. Okay. And he discovered that there was another state. And so he was the first to introduce these two states, okay? But the state introduced by Michael were far away from 10 degrees, was about 50 or something like that. So we discussed with Michael the possibility that within the existing data on albedo, there could be other mechanism providing another state. Since the record show the glacial state, so we assume that this was true, okay? But in fact, if you make this assumption and you assume two states, the only free parameter that you have at that point is the relaxation time. And that again is coming from the estimate by Michael Gill that was about 8 years, more or less. Now, of course, you have to be careful by the fact that all these numbers at least have 20% error.
Okay. Yeah. At least. Yeah. Okay. Now, I was just wondering, since, you know, this is sort of important, I guess, for the scenario, has there been more thinking and work on how to justify it? Has there been any refinement of?
Well, have you seen this? I mean, if you see this paper by the possibility of stochastic resonance in the glacial period, there are a lot of possible mechanisms which can introduce not two states, but many states. In fact, one of the problems of a climate change is not the 2 degrees, is the fact that we can jump to a completely different configuration from which it is very hard to go back. Okay, so discussing about whether the temperature is 2.2 or 2.9 or 1.3 is important because it has a political results, but it's hiding a very crucial question that it's difficult to answer because, of course, the interaction, I mean, even interaction with the phytoplankton in the ocean is not completely clear. And the interaction is one source of CO2 depletion.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Srishti, you had a question? Yeah.
Hello. Thank you, sir, first of all, for this educative talk. And your journey actually really inspires us, so that if a person cannot be, if an idea is not accepted in the society, you should not give up. And it may lead to sometime Nobel Prize also. But I want to comment on the following. I want you to comment on the following statement, that if you have some particular degrees of freedom, and then you cannot control other degrees of freedom. Okay, so then can you treat them as noise? Means as I was thinking that there was temperature, and then there were other factors like radiation and solar temperature radiations in the climate change. But then other factor that like how noise plays a very, very important role in determining the main behavior of the climate change. So I want to know that if noise can be considered in this way or not.
Well, in some sense, yes, it is always a little bit difficult. There were few papers by Maida that were able to put the problems inside the theory of a dynamical system. However, the problem in this climate is really, from the point of view of climate, the problem is ice. Yeah, in the sense that the time scale of ice, it's very long. It's very long compared to the time scale of a response of the atmosphere. So what is in part missing in this approach is the introducing of very long time scale, which are relevant in understanding the dynamics. Now, this long time scale has nothing to do with noise, because are longer than the time scale of the atmosphere response. So I would not say that this long time scale can be used as a noise, but they are driven by the energy balance. So it is not clear whether with our simplified approach, we can, so to speak, take care of this problem or not. In fact, most of the work of Alfonso Sutera after this paper was done with Barry Saltzman in order to understand whether without noise, but with the chaotic dynamics, you can, including the effect of sea ice and ice glaciers, you can recover something similar to what we observe in the stochastic resonance. I don't know if it's an answer to your question.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Maybe it's also a bit late. It's something here. We'll just wait half a minute, Roberto. If not, thank you, Roberto, once again for a wonderful talk as usual.